And now, a special high witness report from the field. Uncle Weed, Uncle Weed, this is the Home Office. Are you there? Are you there? Do you read me? Calling Uncle Weed, calling Uncle Weed. Calling Uncle Weed, do you read me?
Here we are together. It's October 5th, 1955 in San Francisco. I'm going to imagine it's foggy because it's October in San Francisco. We, like other people in the Bay Area, have taken cable cars and buses and taxis and hitched rides to convene on Fillmore Street. Yeah, you've heard of Fillmore Street. For the Gallery 6, which was an old auto body shop, an old auto shop that six artists, hence Six Gallery, had converted into, well, some kind of cooperative art theater. One of them, Wally Hendrick, had put out the word to Kenneth Rexroth, who held poetry salons at his house. Dapper gentleman, kind of the elder statesman of the San Francisco poetry scene at the time. Started to put the word out and said, hey, we ought to do a poetry reading here. Finally, a few poets started to assemble and say, yeah, I'll do that. At the time, you know, keep in mind, San Francisco was in the post-war, leave it to Beaver America. There was lots of Navy people and crew cuts and serious folks around. And poetry, well, it wasn't really a thing, especially getting together and reading poetry out loud to other people. Poetry that didn't rhyme. Poetry that wasn't in a college, university setting. Poetry that wasn't Shakespeare. Well, this was kind of weird. But hey, six poets, six gallery, including the aforementioned Kenneth Rexroth as MC, who appeared in a secondhand store suit, dapper and delightful to host the evening's proceedings, which were headed off by Philip Lamantia, who was, oddly enough, probably the best known of these poets, as he'd been accepted by the Surrealists as a young man in New York City. And he showed up and read poems by a friend who had recently passed away from an incident on something called peyote. Weird. Weird way to start the night too, right? Whoa. Now, whether there are 70 people or 300 people, it's not really sure. The accounts differ, as you might imagine. There's no recording from this, although there's different recordings pieced together from subsequent events. The reason I'm telling you all this is this was the birth of what we now colloquially call the Beat Generation. But the Beat Generation, it's not really for me to say when it started, but let's go to the second reader who later on in his memoir said, and this is Micheal McClure. Here we go. Micheal McClure, handsome fella. And maybe you keeners have seen photos taken from an alley next to City Lights bookstore with Robbie Robertson of the band, Bob Dylan of Bob Dylan, Allen Ginsberg, Lawrence Ferlinghetti wearing his Jedi robe, and this handsome fellow, Micheal McClure, who later toured with Ray Manzarek of the Doors. Bam! Counterculture explosion right there. In all of our memories, no one had been so outspoken in poetry before. We had gone beyond a point of no return. None of us wanted to go back to the gray, chill, militaristic silence, to the intellectual void, to the land without poetry, to the spiritual drabness. We wanted it new, and we wanted to invent it, and the process of it as we went into it. We wanted voice and we wanted vision. So, the handsome Micheal McClure is up next. He goes and reads some poems. The evening is sort of just kind of getting along, but then a new character on the scene had come in from Lowell, Massachusetts in a frenzy of hitchhiking and talking about all these endless scrolls of paper he had typed out in these novels that he was just about to get finished. He had this other novel called Town in the City that was kind of like Thomas Wolfe, not to be confused with Tom Wolfe. It was out, not much, but he had these books out and he had been hitchhiking and he'd been going all over the place with his buddy Dean, Neil, something. He started passing around the hat. Hey, we need money for wine and postcards. Speaking of postcards, besides the poster, they had a postcard to promote the event, and I swear I have it here. Here it is. Six poets at Gallery 6. Philip LaMantia reading late of Mr. John Hoffman, Michael McClure, Allen Ginsberg, Gary Snyder, and Phillip Whalen, all sharp, now straightforward writing, remarkable collection of angels. On one stage, reading their poetry, no charge, small collection for wine and postcards, a charming event, Kenneth Rexroth, MC, 8 p.m. Friday night, October 7, 1955, 6th Gallery, 3119 Fillmore Street. The folks had done their best to sort of decorate, made some sort of surrealist blobby objects out of paper mache to kind of make it look like a setting. What should a poetry reading look like? The stage was about this high, and Jack Kerouac was there sitting with his jug of wine after he had passed it around. Well, three bottles, specifically three large jugs of California Burgundy, were passed around. The crowd started to get a little loosened up and a little into it. And next up came Phillip Whalen. He had done his time as a radio operator in the Army and just returned from a stint at Desolation Peak, being a fire lookout, along with cohorts of this menagerie, Gary Snyder and Jack Kerouac. They had all done different stints working as a fire lookout, which gives you a couple of months to really get inside your head, learn about your own zen, and I don't mean a pop culture zen, and get all that reading that you've always been meaning to do. Later on, I'm just foreshadowing, Phillip Whalen ended up in Japan, a jolly happy fella, and he went up and he did a reading, and everyone's like, yeah, that's all right, man. It's all right. We're going along. We're going along. Rexroth gets up. Oh, should we have an intermission? Yeah. All right. Let's take a couple minutes. Regroup. Next up, we got a guy called Allen Ginsberg. Allen Ginsberg making his public speaking, his poetry speaking debut. Allen Ginsberg was from a East Coast Jewish family. His mom had been institutionalized. He'd been in and out of Columbia University. Had a wild upbringing of his own, but like so many of these characters had come from the East knowing something was happening in the West. Can we get away from the establishment, the publishing establishment, where poetry was run by old tweedy men with pipes and tall office buildings? Can we start something new? He, amongst these other characters, had come West to try to start something new. Jack Kerouac was crashing at his house in Berkeley. They rode the bus over together. Hey, Jack, you want to do some reading of this? Nah. I'm not going to do that. I'll just go and support you guys. And then, out of it all, here comes Allen Ginsberg, nervous, bespectacled with his big horn-rimmed glasses, starts to slowly read out a poem he had just finished just days before called Howl. Dun, 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 dun. Do you want to hear it? Yeah, you do.
I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical, naked, dragging themselves to the Negro streets at dawn looking for an angry fix, who cowered in unshaven rooms in underwear, burning their money in waste baskets and listening to the terror through the wall, who got busted in their pubic beards returning to Laredo with a belt of marijuana for New York, who passed through universities with radiant cool eyes, hallucinating Arkansas and blake light travels.
The poem started slow as he was nervous, wondering what the reaction would be, and then it started building up. They'd say his arms, well, I'll read from Jack Kerouac later, fictionalized the reading in his book, The Dharma Bums. Anyway, I followed the whole gang of howling poets to the reading at Gallery 6, 6th Gallery that night, which was, among other important things, the night of the birth of the San Francisco Poetry Renaissance. Everyone was there. It was a mad night, and I was the one who got things jumping by going around collecting dimes and quarters from the rather stiff audience standing around the gallery and coming back with three huge gallon jugs of California Burgundy and getting them all piffed so that by 11 o'clock with Alva Goldberg, Allen Ginsberg, fictionalized in Dharma Bums, was reading his wailing poem, Whale, Howl, drunk with arms outspread, everyone's yelling, go, 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 like a jam session. And old Reinhold Kathkost, Kenneth Rexroth, the father of the Frisco poetry scene, was wiping tears of gladness. Meanwhile, scores of people stood around the darkened alley, straining to hear every word of the amazing poetry as I wandered from group to group, facing them and facing away from the stage, urging them to slug from the jug, or wandered back and sat on the right side of the stage, giving out little wows and yeses of approvals and whole sentences of comment with nobody's invitation, but in the general gaiety, nobody's disapproval and either. It was a great night. So, while this is going on, another character enters the room, all resplendent in his railroad worker's uniform with gold buttons on, and the man who would be a hero in the poem that Allen was reading, Howell, as well as Jack Kerouac's On the Road. Bam! Neal Cassady fictionalizes Dean Moriarty in here, and he was a character that you've no doubt heard about who connected the beats to the Merry Pranksters as the driver of the Furthur bus. There's so much to say. So in the audience, Jack Kerouac, Neal Cassady, Ann Charters, who later wrote a lovely biography of Jack Kerouac, and Lawrence Ferlinghetti. He was a former naval officer, a war hero, submarine officer, had come to San Francisco as a devoted pacifist and opened a bookstore called City Lights and was looking for poets to publish. Later he said about, and he only passed away last year at 102 years old, and wrote a wonderful book called Coney Island of the Mind as well as others. Anyway, he said years later in 2000, nobody had ever heard anything like that before, says Ferlinghetti, sipping a Bass Ale at Tosca Cafe in North Beach. When you hear it for the first time, you say, I never saw the world like that before. And later, in 1957, after Lawrence Ferlinghetti had published Howl, it was a landmark court case. Because the book had been printed in England, it was seized by customs coming into the U.S., charged with being obscene and seized, and they went through a whole trial about obscenity and censorship. So all that thing, stuff you can read now that might be a little bit puritanical, offensive to your puritanical peers, family, acquaintances, fellow citizens, fellow humans. You're able to read it because of this trial, which said that there's academic and cultural merit in everything. More or less. This City Lights edition of Howl, cha-cha-cha, has gone on to sell over 1 million copies. You should have one yourself. $7.95, available at City Lights or anywhere that you might find small books. And I just love the small size of this. It was made for people to stuff in their backpack, stick in their pocket, and take with them everywhere they go. There we are. Allen Ginsberg just reads Howl, cracks open the artifice with his long biblical prose, talking about how the body is holy in all its weird forms, name-checking marijuana, cold water flats, angel-headed hipsters. Bah! So how do you follow that up? Well, here comes Gary Snyder. Gary's background was significantly different, as he wasn't an East Coaster. He was a Cascadian, like me. From the Pacific Northwest, he'd gone to Reed College, studying anthropology, learning about Asian culture and Native American culture and how they all connect to his own belief system. He was a mountain rambler and a hiker and mountain climber, and he had been the first one to go up here on the peaks, spending three extended stints on Desolation Crater and Sourdough. Learned the works of D.T. Suzuki about Zen, introducing Zen culture from Kanazawa, Japan to North America, and was getting ready to go study Zen in Kyoto, which is a whole other story for another time. How do you follow Allen Ginsberg? Well, Gary Snyder goes up there with his sinewy confidence, hardened from working as a choke setter in logging camps and bagging peaks and hitchhiking 1,000 miles to see a friend. And he reads A Berry Feast, connecting all these cultures, Asian culture and indigenous culture, and who we are as humans and how we connect to the earth. And others would appear in the backcountry. As you can see with the repaired binding, this has gone with me so many places around the world. And I remember my first time coming here to Japan in the early 90s, sitting in a bus station in Kyoto, reading this book, just going, holy shit, I've accidentally stumbled on the same path as this dear gentleman. So Gary reads The evening is a phenomenal success. Everyone's buzzing. You know, sometimes you're somewhere and you've seen a new band, you've seen a new something or other, and you're not quite sure what happens and how to describe it, but you know you're at the start of something remarkable. So, after the reading happens, the poets, and maybe a few others, they head out to Chinese restaurants. They knew something had happened too. They're feasting on Chinese food. Chopsticks were still like a novelty. And knowing that the whole world was going to be a little bit different. Sure enough, from then on out, there was poetry readings. There was a whole scene. This whole renaissance happened. And this is 1955. And over that next 15 years, San Francisco became the cultural epicenter of what we now call counterculture. So, in the aftermath of the Gallery 6 reading, I'm going to read here from The Airship. While the 6th Gallery reading is an undoubtedly monumental event, the content of the poetry read there is as interesting as the figures responsible for shaping and inspiring it. The Beat Generation gave birth to a new age in literature, one that could not have occurred if it had not been for the influence of Kerouac on Ginsberg, of Snyder on Kerouac, of Ginsberg on William S. Burroughs, and Benzedrine of all of them. Now, Benzedrine gets thrown around a lot, and especially with Kerouac typing these long scrolls. And yeah, there was a lot of experimentation with drugs, including, at the time, cannabis was verboten. In fact, Neal Cassady got busted and thrown into San Quentin for 5 years for selling a couple of joints. LSD was illegal for a while, was legal for a while in the early and mid-60s, which changed things a little bit. But this whole mention of cannabis under its various pseudonyms appeared for the first time in popular culture through the works of Kerouac and Ginsberg especially. Each member of the group contributed something of extraordinary significance to the others, and the others returned the favor and then some. It may be the case that the Beat Generation succeeded due to its recognition of its influences and sources of inspiration, eschewing competition or perhaps embracing it good-naturedly in favor of collaboration. The greatest gift these writers may have given to literature is their fearlessness is in exposing themselves. The 6th Gallery reading brought poetry back to its roots as an oral tradition, making literature a thing to be celebrated publicly. Yeah, such truth, right? It's like taking it out of the classroom, taking it out of the ivy-covered walls and saying, this is poetry for everyone. This is jazz. This is culture. This is how we are now. We're shaking loose the confines of post-war, opulent, two cars in every garage America, and we're looking for real meaning in our life. 10 years later, in 1965, the Warlocks, who would later become the Grateful Dead, played the first acid test. In attendance, Ken Babbs and many of the other Merry Pranksters, of course, but also Allen Ginsberg, Neal Cassady, so many of these other characters who then spread out all over the world, sharing this unique culture. As it goes, our guy Gary Snyder soon thereafter shipped off to Japan and was living in a Zen monastery and hooked up with the poet Nanao Sakaki. And years later, of course, returned to North America, bought a big piece of land up in Sierra Nevada, bought a homestead, splitting the land with Allen Ginsberg for a time, and built a whole homestead and still lives there at a wonderful 91 years of age. And in between all of that, Gary and his then wife, Joanne Krieger, the poet, and Alan and his partner, Peter Ovlasky, traveled through India and Nepal, met the Dalai Lama. And again, I found myself on this path, sort of accidentally, following these same steps. And as it goes to years later, 1996 or so, is that 96, 97? 97 at Evergreen College, I had the chance to meet Gary Snyder, and he signed this little picture of himself there, and he said, "Oh yeah, I know you. You're the guy who made a Hempen Road film." I'm like, "Gary, yes I am. Yes I am." He had some words of advice about how to lead a revolution. Phillip Whalen, as I mentioned, Phillip Whalen also went to Japan, later became a full vested Buddhist priest, running a monastery in San Francisco and other points around California, jovial, good-hearted, sweet man. Jack Kerouac went on. So this was before On the Road was published. And On the Road was published, and then it was a huge literary sensation. And Kerouac that 10-year stretch, or a little bit more, rolled out an epic collection of books, which is a whole workshop in itself to even begin to discuss, and developing a whole style of spontaneous prose that was later evidenced by Hunter Thompson. And you know, you see the offshoots, people who are sort of vaguely associated with the Beats, like Richard Brautigan and Charles Bukowski, who kind of bubbled up on their own accord. But the influence of Kerouac and Ginsberg, as well as William S. Burroughs and these other characters, go from, you know, the Grateful Dead to the Simpsons and all points in between, as it were. On the Road, this is the original scroll. Earlier this year, the a facsimile of the original scroll, because the scroll was purchased by Jim Irsay, a wealthy American businessman, for some millions of dollars, and it's taken care of by a Jim Canary, a wonderful bearded gentleman who's a artifact curator, and he travels with it everywhere he goes, like the Stanley Cup. I imagine it's handcuffed to his wrist in a roll. It wasn't one roll. It was long pieces of paper taped together, fed through a typewriter. Anyway, due to current public health restrictions, he couldn't come. So the Japanese printer made an incredible facsimile of the scroll, which is on display, and I was so proud to be able to participate in that event hosted by Professor Matt Theodore, who also has a well-regarded book about the Beats and the West and all of this. And this highly collectible poster, highly collectible now because the event didn't happen, as it were, has your old pal Dave Olson here doing a workshop. There we are. We are the stories we share. You could have come to my workshop if it existed. All right, how to learn more about this stuff. The Beat Museum in North Beach, San Francisco is usually a place you could go to. However, their building, which is right close by City Lights, Cafe Vesuvio, Jack Kerouac Alley in between those, is doing some seismic upgrades. So they've taken the Beat Museum on the road. Cha-cha-cha-cha-cha. Can you believe it? On the road. Beat Museum on the road. There you go. So maybe if you live in the U.S., maybe this will come to your area. Worth checking out, Kerouac.com. I also have a sort of photo essay from my visit there on my web archive. Here's your reading list. Neal Cassady. This book is his one published work. He died under sort of mysterious circumstances in Mexico at far too young of an age. But his children, in particular Jamie Cassady, carry on his traditions and keeping the myth and the legend alive. Here he is. Here's Neal flipping his hammer around La Honda, which is Ken Kesey's ranch. There's Neal and Jack, by a photo by Carolyn Cassady, which no doubt you've seen other places before. And there's the effervescent Carolyn Cassady herself. Anyway, this is the only, depends on how you count it, because there's also the Joan Anderson letter, which I should have close at hand, which is a letter he wrote from San Quentin to Jack Kerouac, all one long block of typing, because he was trying to save paper, because he was in jail, it's hard, and you gotta spend stamps, and the paper's scarce. And this was a huge influence on Jack. The letter was lost for many years. It's resurfaced. It's now a published version of it, the Joan Anderson letter, and the first third 50th anniversary edition, Neal Cassady Estate. I mentioned Gary Snyder and Allen did some traveling together with their various partners and friends. And Allen continued to ramble the world widely. And here's a book by David Wills, who also publishes Beat D-O-M, Allen Ginsberg, World Citizen, and talks about Allen's world travels. Not all of them, I'm just going to skip all that right now. Also, a real fun read. This is Brian Hassett, who wrote a book, Hitchhiking to Kerouac, in 1982 in Boulder, Colorado, where Allen and some others had founded Naropa Institute and the Jack Kerouac School of Disembodied Poets held a big Kerouac workshop. You know, up until kind of recently, even when I was a college student, Kerouac was sort of looked down upon by the literary establishment. Oh, that's not literature. We're very serious. You know, the Faulkner, Hemingway, Fitzgerald, that's American literature. We're cool with that. Twain, oh, yes. But Kerouac and the Beats, no, 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 no. But that's changed. In 82, a whole bunch of these characters got together and had a big conference. My book even got eaten a little bit by a rabbit. A real fun read, and connecting, in later books, connecting the Beats to the Pranksters, to the hippies. There's the yippies in there, and not even on the punks. And Brian, an affable Canadian gent, I love the pictures there of him and his hitchhiking signs, because then I look at me and my hitchhiking signs, and I say, yeah, we're all connected. We're all the same glue. We're all the same. We're all the same tribe in so many ways. One more book I'm going to share to connect it back to my erstwhile home city of Vancouver. This is, Vancouver in the 60s was a real interesting place. And into the 70s, there was a lot of Vietnam-era draft evaders ended up there. There was a bit of a kind bud revolution you may have heard about over the decades to come. And there was a superhuman being, the second annual gathering of the tribe to meet in the meadow of Stanley Park, yay Stanley Park, behind Second Beach for Eastern Sunday being, bring flowers, incense, bright colors, happiness, kites, balloons, god food, drums, bells, children, flutes, and several other things. Gay to the sound of live electric bands along with your own music. Guarantee no paranoia. To help repair any damage that may be done to the meadow, everyone is encouraged to bring along a lot of grass. And oh yes, they did. I learned more about this from Jerry Cruz, who wrote a great book about his, well, performance space, The Afterthought, and all the bands that came through it, including the Grateful Dead's first show outside of California, back in those days. So Allen made some trips and did some readings here in Vancouver that are chronicled in this book. So now you'll notice that when you talk about the Beat Generation, there's a couple other figures that are often mentioned: William Burroughs and Gregory Corso. I didn't dive into them because they weren't. I had to center around this. I centered around this event, and they weren't there. Plus, I'm going to speak to you a little frankly. With Burroughs, there's a lot of darkness involved, man. There's a lot of darkness involved by Burroughs, who, despite his propensity for intravenous drug use and other habits, as well as a dangerous game of William Tell with a gun, lived a long life and ended up being a mentor to people. You may have seen pictures of him and old Kurt Cobain and other characters. And Corso, man, he just like was never my he was just never my thing, you know. If you're curious about more of any of these characters, there's lots more at my web archive. But also, like, let me know, and I'll make another video for you folks here in the Caniverse to talk more about the connections of these characters to herb, to travel, to literature, whatever. If you just want to sit down and I'll read you a storybook, that's fine too. So, how about if we end with one Jack Kerouac haiku? In a very rare edition, and remember previous video we talked about the Japanese binding style for scrapbooks? Here is this Japanese binding style. Drunk as a hoot owl, writing letters by thunderstorm. I love these poems, and I'm very fond of all of you too. Thanks for coming along on this rapid fire breakdown of what happens when you get together with a few friends in a free space, no admission. Throw out a few cents for, you know, wine and postcards. Send out some postcards, make a poster, and you, too, can start a revolution. Very fondly, from Sachita Cottage.
Swing erupted as the Depression began to crack. It was the year marijuana was made illegal, 1937. Young teenagers took to the first restraint, the second, the third. Some still wandered on hobo trains. Lost boys of the 30s numbered in the hundreds of thousands. Salvation armies put up full houses every night, and some were 10 years old. Teenagers, alienated from their parents, who suddenly returned to work and for good to get rid of that damn old mud of the river and tear the rose vine off the porch, and paint the porch white and cut the trees down and castrate the hedges, burn the leaves, build a wire fence, get up an antenna. Listen, the alienated teenager in the 20th century finally ripe. Gone wild, modern, to be rich and prosperous, no more, just around the corner, became the hepcat, the jitterbug, and smoked the new law weed.